The Story of a Mine by Bret Harte. Podcast 2 of 5. Chapter 6. How a Grant Was Got for It. While the Blue Mass Company, with more zeal than discretion, were actively pursuing Pedro and Wiles over the road to Tres Pinos, Señores Miguel and Manuel were comfortably seated in a fonda at Monterey, smoking cigarritos and discussing their late discovery. But they were in no better mood than their late companions, and it appeared from their conversation that in an evil moment they had sold out their interest in the alleged silver mine to Wiles and Pedro for a few hundred dollars, succumbing to what they were assured would be an active opposition on the part of the Americanos. The astute reader will easily understand that the accomplished Mr. Wiles did not inform them of its value as a quicksilver mine, although he was obliged to impart his secret to Pedro as a necessary accomplice and reckless coadjutor. That Pedro felt no qualms of conscience in thus betraying his two comrades may be inferred from his recent direct and sincere treatment of Concho, and that he would, if occasion offered or policy made it expedient, as calmly obliterate Mr. Wiles, that gentleman himself never for a moment doubted. If we had waited but a little he would have given more this cockeye, regretted Manuel querulously. Not a peso, said Miguel, firmly. And why? My Miguel. Thou knowest we could have worked the mine ourselves. Good, and lost even that labor. Look you, little brother. Show to me now the Mexican that has ever made a reel of a mine in California. How many, eh? None. Not a one. Who owns the Mexican's mine, eh? Americanos. Who takes the money from the Mexican's mine? Americanos. Thou rememberest Briones, who spent a gold mine to make a silver one. Who has the lands and house of Briones? Americanos. Who has the cattle of Briones? Americanos. Who has the mine of Briones? Americanos. Who has the silver Briones never found? Americanos. Always the same. Forever. Ah! Caramba! Then the evil one evidently took it into his head and horns to worry and toss these men, comparatively innocent as they were, still further, for a purpose. For presently to them appeared one Victor Garcia, whilom a clerk of the Ayuntamiento, who rallied them over Aguardiente, and told them the story of the quicksilver discovery, and the two mining claims taken out that night by Concho and Wiles. Whereat Manuel exploded with profanity and burnt blue with sulfurous malediction. But Miguel, the recent ecclesiastic, sat livid and thoughtful. Finally came a pause in Manuel's bombardment, and something like this conversation took place between the cooler actors. Miguel, thoughtfully, when was it thou didst petition for lands in the valley, friend Victor? Victor, amazedly, never. It is a sterile waste. Am I a fool? Miguel, softly, thou didst. Of thy governor, Michel Torina. I have seen the application. Victor, beginning to appreciate a rodential odor as I had forgotten. Art thou sure it was in the valley? Miguel, persuasively, in the valley and up the falda. Victor, with decision, certainly. Of a verity the falda likewise. Miguel, eyeing Victor, and yet thou hadst not the grant. Painful is it that it should have been burned with the destruction of the other archives, by the Americanos at Monterey. Victor, cautiously feeling his way possible meant. Miguel, it might be wise to look into it. Victor, bluntly as why. Miguel, for our good and thine, friend Victor. We bring thee a discovery, thou bringest us thy skill, thy experience, thy government knowledge, thy custom house paper. Manuel, breaking in drunkenly, but for what? We are Mexicans. Are we not fated? We shall lose. Who shall keep the Americanos off? Miguel, we shall take one American in. Ha! Seest thou? This American comrade shall bribe his courts, his corregidors. After a little he shall supply the men who invent the machine of steam, the mill, the furnace, et. Victor, but who is he not to steal? Miguel, he is that man of Ireland, a good Catholic, at Tres Pinos. Victor and Manuel, omnes Roscommon. Miguel, of the same. We shall give him a share for the provisions, for the tools, for the aguardiente. It is of the Irish that the Americanos have great fear. It is of them that the votes are made that the president is chosen. It is of him that they make the alcalde in San Francisco. And we are of the church like him. They said bueno altogether, and for the moment appeared to be upheld by a religious enthusiasm, a joint confession of faith that meant death, destruction, and possibly forgery, as against the men who thought otherwise. This spiritual harmony did away with all practical consideration and doubt. I have a little niece, said Victor, whose work with the pen is marvelous. If one says to her, Carmen, copy me this, or the other one, even if it be copperplate, look you, it is done, and you cannot know of which is the original. Madre de Dios. The other day she makes me a rubric of the governor, P.I.O. Pico, the same, identical. Thou knowest her, Miguel. She asked concerning thee yesterday. With the embarrassment of an underbred man, Miguel tried to appear unconcerned, but failed dismally. Indeed, I fear that the black eyes of Carmen had already done their perfect and accepted work, and had partly induced the application for Victor's aid. He, however, dissembled so far as to ask. But will she not know? She is a child. But will she not talk? Not if I say nay, and if thou Miguel. This bit of flattery, which, by the way, was a lie, for Victor's niece did not incline favorably to Miguel, had its effect. They shook hands over the table. But, said Miguel, what is to be done must be done now. At the moment, said Victor, and thou shalt see it done. Does it content thee? Then come. Miguel nodded to Manuel. We will return in an hour, wait thou here. They filed out into the dark, irregular street. Fate led them to pass the office of Dr. Guild at the moment that Concho mounted his horse. The shadows concealed them from their rival, but they overheard the last injunctions of the president to the unlucky Concho. Thou hearest, said Miguel, clutching his companion's arm. Yes, said Victor. But let him ride, my friend, in 1 hour we shall have that shall arrive years before him, and with a complacent chuckle they passed unseen and unheard until, abruptly turning a corner, they stopped before a low adobe house. It had once been a somewhat pretentious dwelling, but had evidently followed the fortunes of its late owner, Don Juan Briones, who had offered it as a last sop to the three-headed Cerberus that guarded the El Refugio Plutonine treasures, and who had swallowed it in a single gulp. It was in very bad case. The furrows of its red-tiled roof looked as if they were the results of age and decrepitude. Its best room had a musty smell, there was the dampness of deliquescence in its slow decay, but the Spanish Californians were sensible architects, and its massive walls and partitions defied the earthquake thrill, and all the year round kept an even temperature within. Victor led Miguel through a low anteroom into a plainly furnished chamber, where Carmen sat painting. Now Mistress Carmen was a bit of a painter, in a pretty little way, with all the vague longings of an artist, but without, I fear, the artist's steadfast soul. She recognized beauty and form as a child might, without understanding their meaning, and somehow failed to make them even interpret her woman's moods, which surely were nature's too. So she painted everything with this innocent lust of the eye: flowers, birds, insects, landscapes, and figures with a joyous fidelity, but no particular poetry. The bird never sang to her but one song, the flowers or trees spake but one language, and her skies never brightened except in color. She came out strong on the Catholic saints, and would toss you up a cleanly shaven Aloysius, sweetly destitute of expression, or a drop cycle, lethargic Madonna that you couldn't have told from an old master, so bad it was. Her faculty of faithful reproduction even showed itself in fanciful lettering and latterly in the imitation of fabrics and signatures. Indeed, with her eye for beauty of form, she had always excelled in penmanship at the convent, an accomplishment which the good sisters held in great repute. In person she was petite, with a still unformed girlish figure, perhaps a little too flat across the back, and with possibly a too great tendency to a boyish stride in walking. Her brow, covered by blue-black hair, was low and frank and honest. Her eyes, a very dark hazel, were not particularly large, but rather heavily freighted in their melancholy lids with sleeping passion. Her nose was of that unimportant character which no man remembers. Her mouth was small and straight, her teeth, white and regular. The whole expression of her face was piquancy that might be subdued by tenderness or made malevolent by anger. At present it was a salad in which the oil and vinegar were deftly combined. The astute feminine reader will of course understand that this is the ordinary superficial masculine criticism, and at once make up her mind both as to the character of the young lady and the competency of the critic. I only know that I rather liked her. And her functions are somewhat important in this veracious history. She looked up, started to her feet, leveled her black brows at the intruder, but, at a sign from her uncle, showed her white teeth and spake. It was only a sentence, and a rather commonplace one at that, but if she could have put her voice upon her canvas, she might have retrieved the Garcia fortunes. For it was so musical, so tender, so sympathizing, so melodious, so replete with the graciousness of womanhood, that she seemed to have invented the language. And yet that sentence was only an exaggerated form of the how do ye do, whined out, doled out, lisped out, or shot out from the pretty mouths of my fair countrywomen. Miguel admired the paintings. He was struck particularly with a crayon drawing of a mule. Mother of God, it is the mule itself, observe how it will not go. Then the crafty Victor broke in with, but it is nothing to her writing, look, you shall tell to me which is the handwriting of P.I.O. Pico, and, from a drawer in the secretary, he drew forth two signatures. One was affixed to a yellowish paper, the other drawn on plain white foolscap. Of course Miguel took the more modern one with lover-like gallantry. This is genuine. Victor laughed triumphantly, Carmen echoed the laugh melodiously in childlike glee, and added, with a slight toss of her piquant head, it is mine. The best of the sex will not refuse a just and overdue compliment from even the man they dislike. It's the principle thereafter, not the sentiment. But Victor was not satisfied with this proof of his niece's skill. Say to her, he demanded of Miguel, what name thou likest, and it shall be done before thee here. Miguel was not so much in love, but he perceived the drift of Victor's suggestion, and remarked that the rubric of Governor Michelterino was exceedingly complicated and difficult. She shall do it, responded Victor, with decision. From a file of old departmental papers the governor's signature and that involved rubric, which must have cost his late excellency many youthful days of anxiety, was produced and laid before Carmen. Carmen took her pen in her hand, looked at the brownish-looking document, and then at the virgin whiteness of the foolscap before her. But, she said, pouting prettily, I should have to first paint this white paper brown. And it will absorb the ink more quickly than that. When I painted the San Antonio of the Mission San Gabriel for Father Acolti, I had to put the decay in with my oils and brushes before the good padre would accept it. The two scamps looked at each other. It was their supreme moment. I think I have, said Victor, with assumed carelessness, I think I have some of the old custom house paper. He produced from the secretary a sheet of brown paper with a stamp. Try it on that. Carmen smiled with childish delight, tried it, and produced a marvel. It is as magic, said Miguel, feigning to cross himself. Victor's role was more serious. He affected to be deeply touched, took the paper, folded it, and placed it in his breast. I shall make a good fool of Don Jose Castro, he said, he will declare it is the governor's own signature, for he was his friend, but have a care, Carmen, that you spoil it not by the opening of your red lips. When he is fooled, I will tell him of this marvel this niece of mine, and he shall buy her pictures. Little one, and he gave her the avuncular caress, i.e., a pat of the hand on either cheek, and a kiss. Miguel envied him, but cupidity outgeneraled Cupid, and presently the conversation flagged, until a convenient recollection of Victor's that himself and comrade were due at the Posada del Toros at 10 o'clock gave them the opportunity to retire. But not without a chance shot from Carmen. "Tell to me," she said, half to Victor and half to Miguel, "what has chanced with Concha? He was ever ready to bring to me flowers from the mountain, and insects, and birds. Thou knowest how he would sit, oh, my uncle, and talk to me of the rare rocks he had seen, and the bears and the evil spirits, and now he comes no longer, my Concha. How is this? Nothing evil has befallen him, surely," and her drooping lids closed half pathetically. Miguel's jealousy took fire. "He is drunk, senorita, doubtless, and has forgotten not only thee but, mayhap, his mule and pack. It is his custom, ha! Ha!" The red died out of Carmen's ripe lips, and she shut them together with a snap like a steel purse. The dove had suddenly changed to a hawk, the child girl into an antique virago, the spirit hitherto dimly outlined in her face, of some shrewish Garcia ancestress, came to the fore. She darted a quick look at her uncle, and then, with her little hands on her rigid lips, strode with two steps up to Miguel. "Possibly, O Señor Miguel Dominguez Porres, a profound courtesy here, it is as thou sayest. Drunkard Concho may be, but, drunk or sober, he never turned his back on his friend or," the words grated a little here, "his enemy." Miguel would have replied, but Victor was ready. "Fool," he said, pinching his arm, "'tis an old friend. And the application is still to be filled up. Are you crazy?" But on this point Miguel was not, and with the revenge of a rival added to his other instincts, he permitted Victor to lead him away. On their return to the fonda, they found Master Manuel too far gone with aguardiente, and a general animosity to the average Americano, to be of any service. So they worked alone, with pen, ink, and paper, in the stuffy, cigarito-clouded back room of the fonda. It was midnight, 2 hours after Concho had started, that Miguel clapped spurs to his horse for the village of Tres Pinos, with an application to Governor Michel Torina for a grant to the Rancho of the Red Rocks comfortably bestowed in his pocket. Chapter 7. Who plead for it? There can be little doubt the coroner's jury of Fresno would have returned a verdict of death from alcoholism, as the result of their inquest into the cause of Concho's death, had not Dr. Guild fought nobly in support of the law and his own convictions. A majority of the jury objected to there being any inquest at all. A sincere juryman thought it hard that whenever a greaser pegged out in a sneaking kind of way, American citizens should be taken from their business to find out what ailed him. "S'pose he was killed," said another, "dar ain't no time this 30 year he weren't, so to speak, just sufferin' for it, easy his natural right easy a Mexican." The jury at last compromised by bringing in a verdict of homicide against certain parties unknown. Yet it was understood tacitly that these unknown parties were several Lee Wiles and Pedro, Manuel, Miguel, and Roscommon, proving an unmistakable alibi. Wiles and Pedro had fled to Lower California, and Manuel, Miguel, and Roscommon deemed it advisable, in the then excited state of the public mind, to withhold the forged application and claim from the courts and the public comment. So that for a year after the murder of Concho and the flight of his assassins, the Blue Mass Mining Company remained in undisturbed and actual possession of the mine, and reigned in their stead. But the spirit of the murdered Concho would not down any more than that of the murdered Banquo, and so wrought, no doubt, in a quiet, Concho-like way, sore trouble with the Blue Mass Company. For a great capitalist and master of avarice came down to the mine and found it fair, and taking one of the company aside, offered to lend his name and a certain amount of coin for a controlling interest, accompanying the generous offer with a suggestion that if it were not acceded to he would be compelled to buy up various Mexican mines and flood the market with quicksilver to the great detriment of the Blue Mass Company, which thoughtful suggestion, offered by a man frequently alluded to as one of California's great mining princes, and as one who had done much to develop the resources of the state, was not to be lightly considered, and so, after a cautious non-consultation with the company, and a commendable secrecy, the stockholder sold out. Whereat it was speedily spread abroad that the great capitalist had taken hold of blue mass, and the stock went up, and the other stockholders rejoiced until the great capitalist found that it was necessary to put up expensive mills, to employ a high-salaried superintendent, in fact, to develop the mine by the spending of its earnings, so that the stock quoted at 112 was finally saddled with an assessment of $50 per share. Another assessment of $50 to enable the superintendent to proceed to Russia and Spain and examine into the workings of the quicksilver mines there, and also a general commission to the gifted and scientific Pilligamon to examine into the various component parts of quicksilver, and report if it could not be manufactured from ordinary sandstone by steam or electricity, speedily brought the other stockholders to their senses. It was at this time the good fellow Tom, the serious-minded Dick, and the speculative but fortunate Harry, brokers of the great capitalist, found it convenient to buy up, for the great capitalist aforesaid, the various other shares at great sacrifice. I fear that I have bored my readers in thus giving the tiresome details of that ingenuous American pastime which my countrymen dismiss in their epigrammatic way as the freezing out process. And lest any reader should question the ethics of the proceeding, I beg him to remember that one gentleman accomplished in this art was always a sincere and direct opponent of the late Mr. John Oakhurst, gambler. But for once the great master of avarice had not taken into sufficient account the avarice of others, and was suddenly and virtuously shocked to learn that an application for a patent for certain lands, known as the Red Rock Rancho, was about to be offered before the United States Land Commission. This claim covered his mining property. But the information came quietly and secretly, as all of the great master's information was obtained, and he took the opportunity to sell out his clouded title and his proprietorship to the only remaining member of the original Blue Mass Company, a young fellow of pith, before many-tongued rumor had voiced the news far and wide. The blow was a heavy one to the party left in possession. Saddled by the enormous debts and expenses of the great capitalist, with the credit now further injured by the defection of this lucky magnate, who was admired for his skill in anticipating a loss, and whose relinquishment of any project meant ruin to it, the single-handed, impoverished possessor of the mine, whose title was contested, and whose reputation was yet to be made, poor Biggs, first secretary and only remaining officer of the Blue Mass Company, looked ruefully over his books and his last transfer, and sighed. But I have before intimated that he was built of good stuff, and that he believed in his work which was well and in himself, which was better, and so, having faith even as a grain of mustard seed, I doubt not he would have been able to remove that mountain of quicksilver beyond the overlapping of fraudulent grants. And, again, Providence having disposed of these several scamps raised up to him a friend. But that friend is of sufficient importance to this voracious history to deserve a paragraph to himself. The Pylades of this Orestes was known of ordinary mortals as Royal Thatcher. His genealogy, birth, and education are, I take it, of little account to this chronicle, which is only concerned with his friendship for Biggs and the result thereof. He had known Biggs a year or two previously, they had shared each other's purses, bunks, cabins, provisions, and often friends, with that perfect freedom from obligation which belonged to the pioneer life. The varying tide of fortune had just then stranded Thatcher on a desert sand hill in San Francisco, with an uninsured cargo of expectations, while to Thatcher's active but not curious fancy it had apparently lifted his friend's bark over the bar in the Monterey Mountains into an open quicksilver sea. So that he was considerably surprised on receiving a note from Biggs to this purport. Dear Roy, run down here and help a fellow. I've too much of a load for one. Maybe we can make a team and pull Blue Mass out yet. Bigsy. Thatcher, sitting in his scantily furnished lodgings, doubtful of his next meal and in arrears for rent, heard this Macedonian cry as St. Paul did. He wrote a promissory and soothing note to his landlady, but fearing the sweet sorrow of personal parting, let his collapsed valise down from his window by a cord, and, by means of an economical combination of stage riding and pedestrianism, he presented himself, at the close of the third day, at Biggs' door. In a few moments he was in possession of the story, half an hour later in possession of half the mine, its infelice past and its doubtful future, equally with his friend. Business over, Biggs turned to look at his partner. "You've aged some since I saw you last," he said. "Starvation luck, I suppose. I'd know your eyes, old fellow, if I saw them among 10,000, but your lips are parched, and your mouth's grimmer than it used to be." Thatcher smiled to show that he could still do so, but did not say, as he might have said, that self-control, suppressed resentment, disappointment, and occasional hunger had done something in the way of correcting nature's obvious mistakes, and shutting up a kindly mouth. He only took off his threadbare coat, rolled up his sleeves, and saying, "We've got lots of work and some fighting before us," pitched into the affairs of the Blue Mass Company on the instant. Chapter 8. Of counsel for it. Meanwhile Roscommon had waited. Then, in Garcia's name, and backed by him, he laid his case before the Land Commissioner, filing the application, with forged endorsements, to Governor Micheltorena, and alleging that the original grant was destroyed by fire. And why? It seemed there was a limit to Miss Carmen's imitative talent. Admirable as it was, it did not reach to the reproduction of that official seal, which would have been a necessary appendage to the governor's grant. But there were letters written on stamped paper by Governor Micheltorena to himself, Garcia, and to Miguel, and to Manuel's father, all of which were duly signed by the sign manual and rubric of Mrs. Governor Micheltorena Carmen de Haro. And then there was parole evidence, and plenty of it, witnesses who remembered everything about it, namely, Manuel, Miguel, and the all-recollecting de Haro. Here were details, poetical and suggestive, and Dame Quicklyish, as when his late excellency, sitting not by a sea-coal fire, but with aguardiente and cigarros, had sworn to him, the ex-ecclesiastic Miguel, that he should grant, and had granted, Garcia's request. There were clouds of witnesses, conversations, letters, and records, glib and pat to the occasion. In brief, there was nothing wanted but the seal of his excellency. The only copy of that was in the possession of a rival school of Renaissance art and the restoration of antiques, then doing business before the Land Commission. And yet the claim was rejected. Having lately recommended two separate claimants to a patent for the same land, the Land Commission became cautious and conservative. Roscommon was at first astounded, then indignant, and then warlike. He was for an apple to Anst. With the reader's previous knowledge of Roscommon's disposition, this may seem somewhat inconsistent, but there are certain natures to whom litigation has all the excitement of gambling, and it should be borne in mind that this was his first lawsuit. So that his lawyer, Mr. Saponaceous Wood, found him in that belligerent mood to which counsel are obliged to hypocritically bring all the sophistries of their profession. "Of course you have your right to an appeal, but calm yourself, my dear sir, and consider. The case was presented strongly, the evidence overwhelming on our side, but we happened to be fighting previous decisions of the Land Commission that had brought them into trouble, so that if Micheltorena had himself appeared in court and testified to his giving you the grant, it would have made no difference. No Spanish grant had a show then, nor will it have for the next 6 months. You see, my dear sir, the government sent out one of its big Washington lawyers to look into this business, and he reported frauds, sir, frauds, in a majority of the Spanish claims.
And why, sir?
Why?
He was bought, sir, bought body and soul by the ring."
"And what's the ring?" asked his client sharply.
"The ring is a hem, a combination of unprincipled but wealthy persons to defeat the ends of justice.
And sure, what's the ring to do with me grant as that thaving Mexican gave me as the collaterals for the board he was owing me?
Eh, mind that now.
The ring, my dear sir, is the other side.
It is a hem.
Always the other side.
And why the divil haven't we a ring too?
And ain't I paying ye $500 and the divil of ring ye have, at all?
What am I paying ye for, eh?
That a judicious expenditure of money," began Mr. Wood, "outside of actual disbursements, may not be of infinite service to you I am not prepared to deny, but
Look ya, Mr. Sappywood, it's the apple I want, and the grant I'll have, more betoken as the old woman's harrut and me own is set on it entirely. Get me the land and I'll give ye the half of it and it's a bargain. But my dear sir, there are some rules in our profession technical though they may be. The divil fly away with your profession. Sure is it better nor me own? If I've risked me provisions and me whiskey, that cost me solid gould in Frisco, on that thave Garcia's claim, bedad. The loiks of ye can risk your law. Well, said Wood, with an awkward smile, I suppose that a deed for one half, on the consideration of friendship, my dear sir, and a dollar in hand paid by me, might be reconcilable. Now it's talkin' ye are. But who's the felly we're foitin', that's got the ring? Ah, my dear sir, it's the United States, said the lawyer with gravity. The States, the government is it? And is t that ye're afeard of? Sure it's the government that I fought in me own count three, it was the government that drove me to America, and is it now that I'm going back on me principles? Your political sentiments do you great credit, began Mr. Wood. But what's the government to do with the apple? The government, said Mr. Wood significantly, will be represented by the district attorney. And who's the spalpeen? It is rumored, said Mr. Wood, slowly, that a new one is to be appointed. I, myself, have had some ambition that way. His client bent a pair of cunning but not overwise gray eyes on his American lawyer. But he only said, ye have, eh? Yes, said Wood, answering the look boldly, and if I had the support of a number of your prominent countrymen, who are so powerful with all parties men like you, my dear sir why, I think you might in time become a conservative, at least more resigned to the government. Then the lesser and the greater scamp looked at each other, and for a moment or two felt a warm, sympathetic, friendly emotion for each other, and quietly shook hands. Depend upon it there is a great deal more kindly human sympathy between two openly confessed scamps than there is in that calm, respectable recognition that you and I, dear reader, exhibit when we happen to oppose each other with our respective virtues. And ye'll get the apple. I will. And he did. And by a singular coincidence got the district attorneyship also. And with a deed for one half of the Red Rock Rancho in his pocket, sent a brother lawyer in court to appear for his client, the United States, as against himself, Roscommon, Garcia, et al. Wild horses could not have torn him from this noble resolution. There is an indescribable delicacy in the legal profession which we literary folk ought to imitate. The United States lost. Which meant ruin and destruction to the Blue Mass Company, who had bought from a paternal and beneficent government lands which didn't belong to it. The Mexican grant, of course, antedated the occupation of the mine by Concho, Wiles, Pedro, etal., as well as by the Blue Mass Company, and the solitary partners, Biggs and Thatcher. More than that, it swallowed up their improvements. It made Biggs and Thatcher responsible to Garcia for all the money the Grand Master of Avarice had made out of it. Mr. District Attorney was apparently distressed, but resigned. Messrs. Biggs and Thatcher were really distressed and combative. And then, to advance a few years in this chronicle, began real litigation with earnestness, vigor, courage, zeal, and belief on the part of Biggs and Thatcher, and technicalities, delay, equivocation, and a general Fabian-like policy on the part of Garcia, Roscommon, et al. Of all these tedious processes I note but one, which for originality and audacity of conception appears to me to indicate more clearly the temper and civilization of the epoch. A subordinate officer of the district court refused to obey the mandate ordering a transcript of the record to be sent up to the United States Supreme Court. It is to be regretted that the name of this Ephesian youth, who thus fired the dome of our constitutional liberties, should have been otherwise so unimportant as to be confined to the dusty records of that doubtful court of which he was a doubtful servitor, and that his claim to immortality ceased with his double feed service. But there still stands on record a letter by this young gentleman, arraigning the legal wisdom of the land, which is not entirely devoid of amusement or even instruction to young men desirous of obtaining publicity and capital. Howbeit, the Supreme Court was obliged to protect itself by procuring the legislation of his functions out of his local fingers into the larger palm of its own attorney. These various processes of law and equity, which, when exercised practically in the affairs of ordinary business, might have occupied a few months' time, dragged, clung, retrograde, or advanced slowly during a period of 8 or 9 years. But the strong arms of Biggs and Thatcher held possession, and possibly, by the same tactics employed on the other side, arrested or delayed ejectment, and so made and sold quicksilver, while their opponents were spending gold, until Biggs, sorely hit in the interlacings of his armor, fell in the lists, his cheek growing waxen and his strong arm feeble, and finding himself in this sore condition, and passing, as it were, made over his share in trust to his comrade, and died. Whereat, from that time henceforward, Royal Thatcher reigned in his stead. And so, having anticipated the legal record, we will go back to the various human interests that helped to make it up. To begin with Roscommon, to do justice to his later conduct and expressions, it must be remembered that when he accepted the claim for the Red Rock Rancho, yet unquestioned, from the hands of Garcia, he was careless, or at least unsuspicious of fraud. It was not until he had experienced the intoxication of litigation that he felt, somehow, that he was a wronged and defrauded man, but with the obstinacy of defrauded men, preferred to arraign some one fact or individual as the impelling cause of his wrong, rather than the various circumstances that led to it. To his simple mind it was made patent that the Blue Mass Company were making money out of a mine which he claimed, and which was not yet adjudged to them. Every dollar they took out was a fresh count in this general indictment. Every delay towards this adjustment of rights, although made by his own lawyer, was a personal wrong. The mere fact that there never was nor had been any quid pro quo for this immense property that it had fallen to him for a mere song only added zest to his struggle. The possibility of his losing this mere speculation affected him more strongly than if he had already paid down the million he expected to get from the mine. I don't know that I have indicated as plainly as I might that universal preference on the part of mankind to get something from nothing, and to acquire the largest return for the least possible expenditure, but I question my right to say that Roscommon was much more reprehensible than his fellows. But it told upon him as it did upon all over whom the spirit of the murdered Concho brooded upon all whom avarice alternately flattered and tortured. From his quiet gains in his legitimate business, from the little capital accumulated through industry and economy, he lavished thousands on this chimera of his fancy. He grew grizzled and worn over his self-imposed delusion. He no longer jested with his customers, regardless of quality or station or importance. He had cliques to mollify, enemies to placate, friends to reward. The grocery suffered, through giving food and lodgment to clouds of unimpeachable witnesses before the Land Commission and the District Court, Mrs. R.O.S. found herself losing money. Even the bar failed. There was a party of Blue Mass employees who drank at the opposite fonda, and cursed the Roscommon claim over the liquor. The calm, mechanical indifference with which Roscommon had served his customers was gone. The towel was no longer used after its perfunctory fashion, the counter remained unwiped, the discs of countless glasses marked its surface, and indicated other preoccupation on the part of the proprietor. The keen gray eyes of the claimant of the Red Rock Rancho were always on the lookout for friend or enemy. Garcia comes next. That gentleman's inborn talent for historic misrepresentation culminated unpleasantly through a defective memory, a year or two after he had sworn in his application for the rancho, being engaged in another case, some trifling inconsistency was discovered in his statements, which had the effect of throwing the weight of evidence to the party who had paid him most, but was instantly detected by the weaker party. Garcia's preeminence as a witness, an expert and general historian began to decline. He was obliged to be corroborated, and this required a liberal outlay of his fee. With the loss of his credibility as a witness, bad habits supervened. He was frequently drunk, he lost his position, he lost his house, and Carmen, removed to San Francisco, supported him with her brush. And this brings us once more to that pretty painter and innocent forger whose unconscious act bore such baleful fruit on the barren hillsides of the Red Rock Rancho, and also to a later blossom of her life, that opened, however, in kindlier sunshine. Chapter 9. What the Fair Had to Do About It? The house that Royal Thatcher so informally quitted in his exodus to the promised land of Biggs was one of those oversized, undercalculated dwellings conceived and erected in the extravagance of the San Francisco builder's hopes, and occupied finally in his despair. Intended originally as the palace of some inchoate California Aladdin, it usually ended as a lodging house in which some helpless widow or hopeless spinster managed to combine respectability with the hard task of bread getting. Thatcher's landlady was one of the former class. She had unfortunately survived not only her husband but his property, and, living in some deserted chamber, had, after the fashion of the Italian nobility, let out the rest of the ruin. A tendency to dwell upon these facts gave her conversation a peculiar significance on the first of each month. Thatcher had noticed this with the sensitiveness of an impoverished gentleman. But when, a few days after her lodger's sudden disappearance, a note came from him containing a draft in noble excess of all arrears and charges, the widow's heart was lifted, and the rock smitten with the golden wand gushed beneficence that shone in a new gown for the widow and a new suit for Johnny, her son, a new oilcloth in the hall, better service to the lodgers, and, let us be thankful, a kindlier consideration for the poor little black-eyed painter from Monterey, then dreadfully behind in her room rent. For, to tell the truth, the calls upon Miss DeHarrow's scant purse by her uncle had lately been frequent, perjury having declined in the Monterey market, through excessive and injudicious supply, until the line of demarcation between it and absolute verity was so finely drawn that Victor Garcia had remarked that he might as well tell the truth at once and save his soul, since the devil was in the market. Mistress Plodgett, the landlady, could not resist the desire to acquaint Carmen DeHarrow with her good fortune. He was always a friend of yours, my dear, and I know him to be a gentleman that would never let a poor widow suffer, and see what he says about you. Here she produced Thatcher's note and read, "Tell my little neighbor that I shall come back soon to carry her and her sketching tools off by force, and I shall not let her return until she has caught the Black Mountains and the Red Rocks she used to talk about, and put the Blue Mass Mill in the foreground of the picture I shall order. What is this, little one? Surely, Carmen, thou needst not blush at this, thy first grand offer. Holy Virgin! Is it of a necessity that thou shouldst stick the wrong end of thy brush in thy mouth, and then drop it in thy lap? Or was it taught thee by the good sisters at the convent to stride in that boyish fashion to the side of thy elders and snatch from their hands the missive thou wouldst read? More of this we would know, O Carmen, smallest of brunettes, speak, little one, even in thine own melodious speech, that I may commend thee and thy rare discretion to my own fair country women." Alas, neither the present chronicler nor Mistress Plodgett got any further information from the prudent Carmen, and must fain speculate upon certain facts that were already known. Mistress Carmen's little room was opposite to Thatcher's, and once or twice, the doors being open, Thatcher had a glimpse across the passage of a black-haired and a sturdy, boyish little figure in a great blue apron, perched on a stool before an easel, and on the other hand, Carmen had often been conscious of the fumes of a tobacco pipe penetrating her cloistered seclusion, and had seen across the passage, vaguely enveloped in the same nicotine cloud, an American Olympian, in a rocking chair, with his feet on the mantel shelf. They had once or twice met on the staircase, on which occasion Thatcher had greeted her with a word or two of respectful yet half-humorous courtesy, a courtesy which never really offends a true woman, although it often piques her self-aplomb by the slight assumption of superiority in the humorist. A woman is quick to recognize the fact that the great and more dangerous passions are always serious, and may be excused if in self-respect she is often induced to try if there be not somewhere under the skin of this laughing Mercutio the flesh and blood of a Romeo. Thatcher was by nature a defender and protector. Weakness, and weakness alone, stirred the depths of his tenderness often, I fear, only through its half-humorous aspects, and on this plane he was pleased to place women and children. I mention this fact for the benefit of the more youthful members of my species, and am satisfied that an unconditional surrender and the complete laying down at the feet of beauty of all strong masculinity is a cheap Gallicism that is untranslatable to most women worthy the winning. For a woman must always look up to the man she truly loves, even if she has to go down on her knees to do it. Only the masculine reader will infer from this that Carmen was in love with Thatcher. The more critical and analytical feminine eye will see nothing herein that might not have happened consistently with friendship. For Thatcher was no sentimentalist, he had hardly paid a compliment to the girl even in the unspoken but most delicate form of attention. There were days when his room door was closed, there were days succeeding these blanks when he met her as frankly and naturally as if he had seen her yesterday. Indeed, on those days following his flight, the simple-minded Carmen, being aware heaven knows how that he had not opened his door during that period, and fearing sickness, sudden death, or perhaps suicide, by her appeals to the landlady, assisted unwittingly in discovering his flight and defection. As she was for a few moments as indignant as Mrs. Plodgett, it is evident that she had but little sympathy with the delinquent. And besides, hitherto she had known only Concho, her earliest friend, and was true to his memory, as against all Americanos, whom she firmly believed to be his murderers. So she dismissed the offer and the man from her mind, and went back to her painting a fancy portrait of the good Padre Junipero Serra, a great missionary, who, happily for the integrity of his bones and character, died some 100 years before the Americans took possession of California. The picture was fair but unsaleable, and she began to think seriously of sign painting, which was then much more popular and marketable. An unfinished head of San Juan de Bautista, artificially framed in clouds, she disposed of to a prominent druggist for $50, where it did good service as exhibiting the effect of 4 bottles of Jones Freckle Eradicator, and in a pleasant and unobtrusive way revived the memory of the saint. Still, she felt weary and was growing despondent, and had a longing for the good sisters and the blameless lethargy of conventual life. And then he came. But not as the prince should come, on a white charger, to carry away this cruelly abused and enchanted damsel. He was sunburned, he was bearded like the pard, he was a little careless as to his dress, and preoccupied in his ways. But his mouth and eyes were the same, and when he repeated in his old frank, half-mischievous way the invitation of his letter, poor little Carmen could only hesitate and blush. A thought struck him and sent the color to his face. Your gentleman born is always as modest as a woman. He ran downstairs, and seizing the widowed Plodgett, said hastily, you're just killing yourself here. Take a change. Come down to Monterey for a day or two with me, and bring Miss De Haro with you for company. The old lady recognized the situation. Thatcher was now a man of vast possibilities. In all maternal daughters of Eve there is the slightest bit of the chaperone and matchmaker. It is the last way of reviving the past. She consented, and Carmen De Haro could not well refuse. The ladies found the blue mass mills very much as Thatcher had previously delivered it to them, a trifle rough and mannish. But he made over to them the one tenement reserved for himself, and slept with his men, or more likely under the trees. At first Mrs. Plodgett missed gas and running water, and these several conveniences of civilization, among which I fear may be mentioned sheets and pillow cases, but the balsam of the mountain air soothed her neuralgia and her temper. As for Carmen, she rioted in the unlimited license of her absolute freedom from conventional restraint and the indulgence of her childlike impulses. She scoured the ledges far and wide alone, she dipped into dark copses, and scrambled over sterile patches of chemisal, and came back laden with the spoil of buckeye blossoms, manzanita berries, and laurel. But she would not make a sketch of the Blue Mass Company's mills on a Mercator's projection, something that could be afterwards lithographed or chromoed, with the mills turning out tons of quicksilver through the energies of a happy and picturesque assemblage of miners, even to please her padrone, Don Royal Thatcher. On the contrary, she made a study of the ruins of the crumbled and decayed red rock furnace, with the black mountain above it, and the light of a dying campfire shining upon it, and the dull red excavations in the ledge. but even this did not satisfy her until she had made some alterations, and when she finally brought her finished study to Don Royal, she looked at him a little defiantly. Thatcher admired honestly, and then criticized a little humorously and dishonestly. "But couldn't you, for a consideration, put up a signboard on that rock with the inscription, Road to the Blue Mass Company's New Mills to the Right, and combine business with art? That's the fault of you geniuses. But what's this blanketed figure doing here, lying before the furnace? You never saw one of my miners there and a Mexican, too, by his serape. That, quoth Mistress Carmen, coolly, was put in to fill up the foreground. I wanted something there to balance the picture. But," continued Thatcher, dropping into unconscious admiration again, "it's drawn to the life. Tell me, Mr. Harrow, before I ask the aid and counsel of Mrs. Plodgett, who is my hated rival, and your lay figure and model." "Oh," said Carmen, with a little sigh, "it's only poor Caucho." "And where is Concho?" A little impatiently. "He's dead, Don Royal. Dead. Of a verity very dead, murdered by your countrymen. I see and you know him. He was my friend." "Oh. Truly. But, wickedly, isn't this a rather ghastly advertisement outside of an illustrated newspaper of my property?" "Ghastly, Don Royal. Look you, he sleeps. I, in Spanish, as the dead." Carmen, crossing herself hastily, after the fashion of the dead. They were both feeling uncomfortable. Carmen was shivering. But, being a woman, and tactful, she recovered her head first. "It is a study for myself, Don Royal, I shall make you another." And she slipped away, as she thought, out of the subject and his presence. But she was mistaken. In the evening he renewed the conversation. Carmen began to fence, not from cowardice or deceit, as the masculine reader would readily infer, but from some wonderful feminine instinct that told her to be cautious. But he got from her the fact, to him before unknown, that she was the niece of his main antagonist, and, being a gentleman, so redoubled his attentions and his courtesy that Mrs. Plodgett made up her mind that it was a foregone conclusion, and seriously reflected as to what she should wear on the momentous occasion. But that night poor Carmen cried herself to sleep, resolving that she would hereafter cast aside her wicked uncle for this good-hearted Americano, yet never once connected her innocent penmanship with the deadly feud between them. Women, the best of them, are strong as to collateral facts, swift of deduction, but vague as children are to the exact statement or recognition of premises. It is hardly necessary to say that Carmen had never thought of connecting any act of hers with the claims of her uncle, and the circumstance of the signature she had totally forgotten. The masculine reader will now understand Carmen's confusion and blushes, and believe himself an ass to have thought them a confession of original affection. The feminine reader will, by this time, become satisfied that the deceitful minx's sole idea was to gain the affections of Thatcher. And really I don't know who is right. Nevertheless she painted a sketch of Thatcher which now adorns the company's office in San Francisco, in which the property is laid out in pleasing geometrical lines, and the rosy promise of the future instinct in every touch of the brush. Then, having earned her wage, as she believed, she became somewhat cold and shy to Thatcher. Whereat that gentleman redoubled his attentions, seeing only in her presence a certain méprise, which concerned her more than himself. The niece of his enemy meant nothing more to him than an interesting girl to be protected, always to be feared, never. But even suspicion may be insidiously placed in noble minds. Mistress Plodgett, thus early estopped of matchmaking, of course put the blame on her own sex, and went over to the stronger side, the man's. "It's a great pity gals should be so curious," she said, sotto voce, to Thatcher, when Carmen was in one of her sullen moods. "Yet I suppose it's in her blood. Them Spaniards is always revengeful like the Eidolians." Thatcher honestly looked his surprise. "Why, don't you see, she's thinking how all these lands might have been her uncle's but for you. And instead of trying to be sweet," and here she stopped to cough. "Good God," said Thatcher in great concern, I never thought of that. He stopped for a moment, and then added with decision, I can't believe it, it isn't like her. Mrs. P was piqued. She walked away, delivering, however, this Parthian arrow, well, I hope 'tain't nothing worse. Thatcher chuckled, then felt uneasy. When he next met Carmen, she found his gray eyes fixed on hers with a curious, half-inquisitorial look she had never noticed before. This only added fuel to the fire. Forgetting their relations of host and guest, she was absolutely rude. Thatcher was quiet but watchful, got the Plodget to bed early, and, under cover of showing a moonlight view of the Lost Chance Mill, decoyed Carmen out of earshot, as far as the dismantled furnace. What is the matter, Miss De Harrow, have I offended you? Miss Carmen was not aware that anything was the matter. If Don Royal preferred old friends, whose loyalty of course he knew, and who were above speaking ill against a gentleman in his adversity, oh, Carmen, fie, if he preferred their company to later friends why, the masculine reader will observe this tremendous climax and tremble, why she didn't know why he should blame her. They turned and faced each other. The conditions for a perfect misunderstanding could not have been better arranged between two people. Thatcher was a masculine reasoner, Carmen a feminine feeler, if I may be pardoned the expression. Thatcher wanted to get at certain facts, and argue therefrom. Carmen wanted to get at certain feelings, and then fit the facts to them. But I am not blaming you, Miss Carmen, he said gravely. It was stupid in me to confront you here with the property claimed by your uncle and occupied by me, but it was a mistake. No, he added hastily, it was not a mistake. You knew it, and I didn't. You overlooked it before you came, and I was too glad to overlook it after you were here. Of course, said Carmen pettishly, I am the only one to be blamed. It's like you men. M.E.M. She was just 15, and uttered this awful resume of experience just as if it hadn't been taught to her in her cradle. Feminine generalities always stagger a man. Thatcher said nothing. Carmen became more enraged. Why did you want to take Uncle Victor's property, then? She asked triumphantly. I don't know that it is your uncle's property. You don't know? Have you seen the application with Governor Micheltorena's endorsement? Have you heard the witnesses? She said passionately. Signatures may be forged and witnesses lie, said Thatcher quietly. What is it you call forged? Thatcher instantly recalled the fact that the Spanish language held no synonym for forgery. The act was apparently an invention of El Diablo Americano. So he said, with a slight smile in his kindly eyes. Anybody wicked enough and dexterous enough can imitate another's handwriting. When this is used to benefit fraud, we call it forgery. I beg your pardon, Miss De Harrow, Miss Carmen, what is the matter? She had suddenly lapsed against a tree, quite helpless, nerveless, and with staring eyes fixed on his. As yet an embryo woman, inexperienced and ignorant, the sex's instinct was potential, she had in one plunge fathomed all that his reason had been years groping for. Thatcher saw only that she was pained, that she was helpless, that was enough. It is possible that your uncle may have been deceived, he began. Many honest men have been fooled by clever but deceitful tricksters, men and women. Stop. Madre de Dios. Will you stop? Thatcher for an instant recoiled from the flashing eyes and white face of the little figure that had, with menacing and clenched baby fingers, strode to his side. He stopped. Where is this application, this forgery? She asked. Show it to me. Thatcher felt relieved, and smiled the superior smile of our sex over feminine ignorance. You could hardly expect me to be trusted with your uncle's vouchers. His papers, of course, are in the hands of his counsel. And when can I leave this place? She asked passionately. If you consult my wishes, you will stay, if only long enough to forgive me. But if I have offended you unknowingly, and you are implacable, I can go tomorrow at sunrise if I like. As you will, returned Thatcher gravely. Gracias, senor. They walk slowly back to the house, Thatcher with a masculine sense of being unreasonably afflicted, Carmen with a woman's instinct of being hopelessly crushed. No word was spoken until they reached the door. Then Carmen suddenly, in her old, impulsive way, and in a childlike treble, sang out merrily, "Good night, O Don Royal, and pleasant dreams. Hasta mañana." Thatcher stood dumb and astounded at this capricious girl. She saw his mystification instantly. "It is for the old cat," she whispered, jerking her thumb over her shoulder in the direction of the sleeping Mrs. P. "Good night, go." He went to give orders for a peon to attend the ladies and their equipage the next day. He awoke to find Miss De Harrow gone, with her escort, towards Monterey. And without the plaget. He could not conceal his surprise from the latter lady. She, left alone and not altogether unavailable victim to the wiles of our sex, was embarrassed. But not so much that she could not say to Thatcher, "I told you so," gone to her uncle. To tell him all. All. "D-n it, what can she tell him?" roared Thatcher, stung out of his self-control. "Nothing, I hope, that she should not," said Mrs. P., and chastely retired. She was right. Miss Carmen posted to Monterey, running her horse nearly off its legs to do it, and then sent back her beast and escort, saying she would rejoin Mrs. Plodgett by steamer at San Francisco. Then she went boldly to the law office of Saponaceous Wood, district attorney and whilom solicitor of her uncle. With the majority of masculine Monterey, Miss Carmen was known and respectfully admired, despite the infelix reputation of her kinsman. Mr. Wood was glad to see her, and awkwardly gallant. Miss Carmen was cool and businesslike. She had come from her uncle to regard the papers in the Red Rock Rancho case. They were instantly produced. Carmen turned to the application for the grant. Her cheek paled slightly. With her clear memory and wonderful fidelity of perception, she could not be mistaken. The signature of Michelle Torino was in her own handwriting. Yet she looked up to the lawyer with a smile, "May I take these papers for an hour to my uncle?" Even an older and better man than the district attorney could not have resisted those drooping lids and that gentle voice. "Certainly. I will return them in an hour." She was as good as her word, and within the hour dropped the papers and a little courtesy to her uncle's legal advocate, and that night took the steamer to San Francisco. The next morning Victor Garcia, a little the worse for the previous night's dissipation, reeled into Wood's office. "I have fears for my niece Carmen. She is with the enemy," he said thickly. "Look you at this." It was an anonymous letter, in Mrs. Plodgett's own awkward fist, advising him of the fact that his niece was bought by the enemy, and cautioning him against her. "Impossible," said the lawyer, "it was only last week she sent the $50. Victor blushed, even through his ensanguined cheeks, and made an impatient gesture with his hand. "Besides," added the lawyer coolly, "she has been here to examine the papers at thy request, and returned them of yesterday." Victor gasped, "And you gave them to her?" "Of course. All. Even the application and the signature." "Certainly you sent her." "Sent her? The devil's own daughter," shrieked Garcia. "No. 100,000,000 times, no. Quick, before it is too late. Give to me the papers." Mr. Wood reproduced the file. Garcia ran over it with trembling fingers until at last he clutched the fateful document. Not content with opening it and glancing at its text and signature, he took it to the window. "It is the same," he muttered with a sigh of relief. "Of course it is," said Mr. Wood sharply. "The papers are all there." "You're a fool, Victor Garcia." And so he was. And, for the matter of that, so was Mr. Saponaceous Wood, of counsel. Meanwhile Miss De Harrow returned to San Francisco and resumed her work. A day or two later she was joined by her landlady. Mrs. P. had too large a nature to permit an anonymous letter, written by her own hand, to stand between her and her demeanor to her little lodger. So she coddled her and flattered her and depicted in slightly exaggerated colors the grief of Don Royal at her sudden departure. All of which Miss Carmen received in a demure, kitten-like way, but still kept quietly at her work. In due time Don Royal's order was completed, still she had leisure and inclination enough to add certain touches to her ghastly sketch of the crumbling furnace. Nevertheless, as Don Royal did not return, through excess of business, Mrs. Plodgett turned an honest penny by letting his room, temporarily, to two quiet Mexicans, who, but for a beastly habit of cigarrito smoking which tainted the whole house, were fair enough lodgers. If they failed in making the acquaintance of their fair countrywoman, Miss De Harrow, it was through the lady's preoccupation in her own work, and not through their ostentatious endeavors. "Miss De Harrow is peculiar," explained the politic Mrs. Plodgett to her guests, "she makes no acquaintances, which I consider bad for her business. If it had not been for me, she would not have known Royal Thatcher, the great Quicksilver miner, and had his order for a picture of his mine." The two foreign gentlemen exchanged glances. One said, "Ah, God, this is bad," and the other, "It is not possible," and then, when the landlady's back was turned, introduced themselves with a skeleton key into the then vacant bedroom and studio of their fair countrywoman, who was absent sketching. "Thou observest," said Mr. Pedro, refugee, to Miguel, ex-ecclesiastic, "that this Americano is all-powerful, and that this victor, drunkard as he is right in his suspicions." "Of a verity, yes," replied Miguel, "thou dost remember it was Jovita Castro who, for her Americano lover, betrayed the Sabrent claim. It is only with us, my Pedro, that the Mexican spirit, the real God and liberty, yet lives." They shook hands nobly and with sentimental fervor, and then went to work, i.e., the rummaging over the trunks, drawers, and portmanteaus of the poor little painter, Carmen De Harrow, and even ripped up the mattress of her virginal cot. But they found not what they sought. "What is that yonder on the easel, covered with a cloth?" said Miguel. "It is a trick of these artists to put their valuables together." Pedro strode to the easel and tore away the muslin curtain that veiled it, then uttered a shriek that appalled his comrade and brought him to his side. "In the name of God," said Miguel hastily, "are you trying to alarm the house?" The ex-vaquero was trembling like a child. "Look," he said hoarsely, "look, do you see? It is the hand of God," and fainted on the floor. Miguel looked. It was Carmen's partly finished sketch of the deserted furnace. The figure of Concho, thrown out strongly by the campfire, occupied the left foreground. But to balance her picture she had evidently been obliged to introduce another, the face and figure of Pedro, on all fours, creeping towards the sleeping man.